Everyone, good afternoon. My name is Sarah Sikic and I work in support of partnerships and fundraising with UC Santa Barbara's National Center for Ecological Analysis and Synthesis, or NCEAS. We're so glad you could join us today. NCEAS is celebrating our 25th anniversary this year, and we're really happy to have you here as part of this celebratory seminar series. You're in for a treat today with a panel featuring one of our flagship partnership programs, the Ocean Health Index, a global tool co-created by NCEAS and now used around the world as a barometer and planning tool for ocean health and management. In fact, the Global Ocean Health Index scores for 2020 were just released on Monday. Before we get started with the program, I'd like to just go over a few housekeeping items and provide a quick introduction. This will be a moderated panel discussional in webinar format, so please feel free to type any questions that you have into the chat function at any time. And if you have any technical issues during the webinar, please feel free to contact the UCSB virtual event staff in the chat function. Especially in these unprecedented times, it's a great privilege to be part of the forward-thinking, creative, and adaptable community at NCEAS, a community of researchers dedicated to accelerating science to address pressing problems facing people and the planet. NCEAS is a research center affiliated with UC Santa Barbara. We bring together experts from diverse disciplines throughout the world to tackle some of the biggest challenges facing our planet, from water pollution to declining biodiversity. We are all about open science and data sharing, working together to look across data sets and experiences to advance environmental and ecological solutions. For example, we've brought together researchers, environmental nonprofits, insurance companies, and urban planners to quantify the economic benefits of coastal habitats, like dunes and wetlands, to buffer against intense storms and sea level rise stemming from climate change. We are also convening public health experts and forest managers to work together to better understand the relative impact of wildfire and prescribed burns on human health in order to inform and improve forestry practices. With dozens of working groups that come through our center each year, and now we're convening online, there are many more stories like this that can be told about the global environmental impact we are making at NCEAS. NCEAS pioneered this multidisciplinary working group approach 25 years ago, and since then, we've hosted over 20,000 researchers from more than 75 countries around the world. We are also a leader in the space of environmental data science, advancing open science techniques to accelerate discovery and search solutions to environmental problems. From short data science boot camps to multi-year postdoctoral research opportunities, we are providing a launch pad for the next generation of environmental scientists. I hope that you enjoy learning more about our work today and join us for future events as we celebrate our 25th anniversary this year. So now I have the pleasure of introducing you to our panel. First, I have Emily Shumchenia. She's a marine scientist with E&C Enviroscape and the Northeast Regional Ocean Council. Her work focuses on the interface between coastal and ocean science and management. Welcome, Emily. Next, we have Erich Pacheco, Equity and Policy Manager at Portland Water Bureau and former Director of Global Ocean Governance and Policy for Conservation International. His career has centered on the nexus across the environment, human well-being, and economic development. We also have Courtney Scarborough joining us, Deputy Director for NCEAS. She's a marine scientist that has been with the Ocean Health Index since its inception and has worked to tailor numerous localized assessments for this program. And last, but certainly not least, is Ben Halpern. He's the director of NCEAS and co-founder of the Ocean Health Index. Ben has been involved with NCEAS for more than two decades, and he's also a professor at UC Santa Barbara's Bren School of Environmental Science and Management. Please join me with a warm but quiet Zoom welcome for our panel.
Thank you, Sarah, for that great introduction. And it is so wonderful to see old and current friends here online with me today. This is a bit of a reunion, getting the band back together for folks who've been involved with Ocean Health Index at various stages. And it's a really exciting moment, as Sarah mentioned for the index, we just launched our global scores this week, and next year will be the 10th anniversary of doing the global assessment. And we've seen uptake of the index in 30 or more countries around the world and lots of other regions. So it's been an exciting growth phase, and to have Eric and Emily and Courtney here to share their experiences and thoughts as they've been part of this trajectory at different phases and in different roles and partnerships with the initiative. It's really fun. So I'm excited to be here together with all of you and for the folks joining us to share these insights and thoughts about how the Ocean Health Index project does work and how it represents a really exciting example of how NCEAS operates in this space. So with no further ado, I'm going to jump into some questions because this is where it gets really fun to hear people's thoughts on stuff. So I guess a good place to start is kind of at the core of what the Ocean Health Index is and tries to do. So it defines a healthy ocean as one that includes human well-being, which is a bit different than the way people often think about conservation and kind of healthy or pristine oceans. In fact, we say that a healthy ocean sustainably delivers a range of benefits to people, both now and in the future. So I'm curious, maybe Eric and then Courtney, to give your thoughts on why you think including humans in the index is and has been important.
Yeah, it's great to see you, Ben. I'm really happy to be here with all of you today. I worked on the Ocean Health Index for about 5 years, and I got to go to pretty much every continent and see how different people interacted with it in different cultures. And one thing that was universal is that it is humans who are making decisions about about ocean health. You know, if the whales and the sharks and the reefs could vote, there would be a different story maybe. But when you look at, you know, who are the driving players behind all the habitat destruction, the pollution, introduction of the invasive species, it is largely private players, humans, and often sanctioned by states, by governments. So if we do not make explicit the links between ocean health and human well-being, it's really going to be difficult for us to articulate in a way that is convincing to those making decisions on why they should protect the ocean and coastal resources. And there's, you know, also an equity component to this. You know, when we look at who are some of the most vulnerable populations around the world, they're coastal populations who are predominantly low income, subsistence populations, often marginalized ethnic or racial groups. A lot of times they're women groups, right? So when we look at a fishery that's depleted, as it happened around Somali area, and we take away the livelihoods of those people, well, they're going to turn to piracy, right? Or when we look at habitats being destroyed because of hurricanes or because of sea level rise, and we've push populations to migrate, right? They're going to collide with other populations. And we see that the number one cause for conflict and war around the world is a fight around resources. And it's no different for ocean resources. So if our intention is really to preserve the ocean, to protect the ocean, we really have to create a strong narrative between ocean health and human well-being. And those two things are interconnected. And so that's why I think the Ocean Health Index is unique and so essential, and why it's been so compelling to a lot of decision makers around the world.
That's great. Thanks, Eric. Courtney, do you have additional thoughts? Or?
Yeah, that was really insightful. Thanks, Eric. The other piece of it for me is, you know, going into the Ocean Health Index over 10 years ago, we at NCEAS had done previous work that showed that there's nowhere in the world that has not been impacted by humans. And that goes for the oceans. We created the first global map of where humans are impacting the ocean, and there is not anywhere in the world. And so we came out of that experience, I think, realizing that so much of the work that's being done in science is showing how humans are negatively impacting the oceans, but there was nothing that helped quantify how humans were benefiting from the ocean. And I think that's what this Ocean Health Index really sought to quantify a bit better, not just the negative impacts, but all the benefits people are getting and understanding those dynamics, like Eric was saying, of how humans interact with their environment, that there are positives and there are negatives, and we really need to get sort of a full accounting of all of those interactions to be able to not only understand what's going on in the ocean, but also communicate it back to people so that they can understand sort of how the oceans are changing, both for good and bad, and how they see themselves in the ocean world and how they see themselves benefiting from the ocean. So I think it sort of was born out of this realization that we didn't have a good understanding of how people were benefiting. And it's, as Eric said, it's a nice way to also communicate back to people so they see themselves in this piece, in this Ocean Health Index.
Great, thanks, Courtney. All right, Emily, I wanna ask you a question. We've been working with you the last almost 5 years in the Northeast region of the United States, and you've been really deeply involved in this effort in a partnership with us. So I'm curious your perspective on what makes the Ocean Health Index unique compared to other projects that monitor and assess the ocean, and in particular, how have partnerships helped advance these qualities?
Yeah, thanks, Ben, and thanks for having me today. I'm very excited to talk about OHI. My experience with OHI, like you mentioned, is shorter than the rest of you and also a narrower geographic focus, but it's from an area that I think is maybe one of the most monitored places in the country. There are some data sets out here in the Northeast that are, you know, almost 100 or sometimes exceeding 100 years old. And that's a really exciting thing to try to understand and synthesize that data. I've worked with lots of groups in this region and in neighboring areas on the Atlantic coast that struggle to build programs to monitor indicators and then select indicators and then figure out what those indicators mean and how to set targets and how to track progress. And then very recently, folks are asking of us, well, how do we now link our monitoring data to ecosystem services and the things that we care about? And what I love about the Ocean Health Index is that it presents all of that in a nice package. It's a great framework that is already established, but it's also flexible. So you can actually customize it to whatever region or place or particular location, what the priorities are of that location. So it presents a structure without being overly prescriptive and overly prohibitive. It's like, you know, sitting at a table with a document to edit instead of a blank piece of paper where you have to start, you know, stream of consciousness trying to write something down. It really helps get the conversation started. It hits right at the issues that people are already thinking about when they think about why we want to do monitoring. It just gives them the tools to start that conversation from a place that would, I think, save them years, quite frankly, based on my experience working with some groups in this region. Folks go over and over lists of indicators to try to figure out what they want to do and then find out later that they weren't monitoring the right thing or the thing that they actually cared about. So that's the real value I see of OHI as that framework.
Great, thanks. So as was alluded to, and you mentioned, Courtney, you've been part of the index since day one, which is a long and exciting path. I'm curious your perspective, and then also Eric, who you were part of it for, you know, the middle years in a really profound way. Like, what are some of the challenges you faced working to implement the Ocean Health Index in various places? You know, now that you've had time to really reflect on this, you know, is there anything you would approach differently?
From my perspective, I think the longer I've worked on the Ocean Health Index, the more I've realized not only is the Ocean Health Index about people, but getting the Ocean Health Index right in a place is about building the partnership and interacting with the people and making sure that you're building trust and kind of getting all the pieces and players in place to make it as impactful as possible. And that takes time. And so I think like getting the right coalition together and building trust takes about twice as long as you, at least as you may expect going into a project. And it's kind of the most important part of the project. So I think, you know, for me, if I were to go into a new Ocean Health Index, I would plan on it taking twice as long as you may expect. and I would also make sure that you always get the right partners on board from the beginning. And I think our work with Emily in the Northeast has been just like such a great example of that for me. Emily has been like an amazing partner in this project, and there's no way that the Northeast project would have been as successful as it was without having Emily and her team on board from the beginning, and having their regional knowledge, having their, you know, connections to the people and to the place, and getting that right is like almost, you know, is the very fundamentals of it, and it takes a while. So putting partnerships and trust up front, making sure you get those right, and then moving on to the more, you know, science work is kind of how I would, what I would say for future Ocean Health Indexes to focus on.
Great, thanks, Eric. Any thoughts?
Yeah, it's funny because the first thing I hear is like, it takes a long time. That's the first thing I wrote in my notes. You know, when I reflect on kind of the places that I always try to go, and I remember Ben and I having this conversation, it's like, ooh, should we go to Kenya? That's a hard place to work in, right? And, but you know, when you look at the places with some of the highest concentrations of marine biodiversity around the world, right? The Coral Triangle or the Western Indian Ocean or the South Pacific. These are places that have weak governance, right? They have weak institutions, limited scientific capacity, but we have to get it right in those places, right? If we don't get ocean health right in those places that are the bastion of marine biodiversity, what are we doing, right? And so it takes a long time because it's not just about developing the scientific capacity of those places. If it was as simple as just getting the science right, we've seen it even in the US, right? It's not just about the science. You need to have the right coalitions together, right? The right partners. So you need, you know, who are the nonprofits involved that are going to not just have a say in how things are done, but implementing whatever changes need to be done. You need the governments to have a say. So you need time to get policies in place that change practices, change management, change structures. And one of the beauty things about the Ocean Health Index is how integrated it is, right? But when you look at how structures are managed, ocean management structures around the world, they're incredibly siloed. You know, you got fisheries with agriculture over here, and you got, you know, the economic and livelihoods are in the economic ministry over there, and they don't talk to each other, right? So sometimes when we would come in, we would be the first kind of program bringing these people to work together. And so setting these things up takes a long time, and I will do a pitch there, and this is where the funding model really gets tricky, right? Because donors oftentimes, you know, they invest, they're like, oh, I'll give you funding for a year. And I'm like, okay, I mean, that's better than nothing, but it's going to take multiple years for us to see changes in some of these areas. And that's where, you know, it gets tricky. We need really long-term funding that is going to allow us to have meaningful and deeper investments in these areas, to build coalitions, to get to that sustainability is going to take time. And that's now that I work for a water utility in Oregon. You know, it's an ecosystem service. People are not paying for the water. They're paying for the water service, right? And I think of like, what would it be like to have a utility model for ocean conservation? I remember Steve Katona had this idea of maybe having like a tax on like shipping containers or something like that. But I don't know if that's the right solution, but having some sustainable funding models, and that's something that entire conservation movement hasn't cracked yet. And I will say the other thing is that, you know, working at Conservation International nonprofits, you know, it was like chasing the numbers. Oh, we want more numbers. We want more countries. And I remember that was the pressure. And in retrospect, I can't say that was the right approach. And we talked a lot about that, you know. That really came at the peril of actually, we went thin and wide, but we didn't go deep in a lot of the places. And in retrospect, I would have liked to have fewer places where we could have focused and go way deeper and really drive those partnerships and those collaborations in a more meaningful way.
Great, thanks. So Emily and Eric, you both are primarily outside of academia and certainly connect more than Courtney and I do with folks outside of academia. I'm curious your perspectives on why you think the Ocean Health Index has resonated so much with people outside of academia. Maybe Emily first and then Eric.
Yeah, I'll jump in. Having spent a significant amount of time in academia and then outside, I can't decide who is more critical of structures like this. But no, I think that it does really resonate with people outside of academia for a number of reasons. But one, maybe that I'll just pick on here, because I think there's opportunities to talk about some of the others later on too. The data visualization work that you guys have done to support OHI is just fantastic. It's very consistent across OHI assessments. It's intuitive. It's engaging and colorful, and, you know, at a very simple level. But I think it actually draws people into the data, and that is a really often overlooked part of assessments, and especially trend analyses can get really sciencey with complicated graphs and things like that. And you know, not to say that you don't have some complex visualizations that go along with OHI, but I think that the data visualization piece cannot be overlooked, and that you guys do a great job with that.
Thanks. Eric?
Yeah, I started alluding a little bit to this earlier, you know, again, when we look at how oceans are managed, I think a lot of people, when we would go to countries, I was like, oh, let's talk to the Ministry of Environment. And we were like, well, you know, there are production things here, like fisheries and natural products. We also have coastal livelihoods and tourism. So it's not just like the Ministry of Environment's not going to have all the right capacities. And so one of the beautiful things that I thought the Ocean Health Index provided is really a framework to have meaningful and deep conversations about integrated management of natural resources. Oftentimes it's said, like, why aren't we doing this on the terrestrial side, right? Because the terrestrial side is incredibly siloed as well. So the Ocean Health Index really provided all of these different players and different stakeholders to work towards a joint vision, right? Like, I thought one of the most, the greatest thing about the Ocean Health Index was the process of creating locally specific targets for each one of these goals. And what do those mean? So like, what do local fisheries mean for us, right? From a cultural perspective, right? From an economic perspective, not just from the food provision element, right? What does it mean to have a thriving coastal tourism industry that is supportive of coastal habitats? And, you know, you see this kind of tensions rise, and it gives a great platform to have these wonderful conversations. And to add to what Emily was just saying, the communications piece of it, right? It's easy to grasp. It's easy to understand. You don't have to be an ocean expert to be like, okay, here are the 10 things I need to be focused my attention to. Here are the resilience components I need to be paying attention to that kind of prop that up in a positive way. And here's the negative pressures that are bringing me down. So it's easy to communicate. It kind of stays away from the jargon at the surface level. And, you know, those circular, you can easily see, okay, how far am I from where I need to be? And so those are conversation starters, and it really allows for that participatory decision-making of bringing stakeholders together in a way that more scientific, rigorous, you know, pristine ocean data things just don't have those natural inways for non-scientists to have those conversations.
Yeah, thanks, Eric. So Courtney, you sort of alluded to this already in one of your responses about what was one of the motivations for kind of starting the Ocean Health Index and how it changed a little bit your perspective or thinking about ocean management. But maybe if everyone can reflect a little bit on you know, if or how working on the Ocean Health Index changed your perspective about ocean science, ocean management, ocean conservation, how our discipline, how our work relates to what we're trying to achieve with ocean health. Maybe Courtney, you can start.
Yeah, I think I have alluded to this a bit, and so is Eric and Emily. And I think for me, you know, the thing that changed once I started working on this was, you know, I thought of myself as a scientist and I was doing science. When you start to look at management and how you measure healthy ecosystems, you start to realize how important the social dimensions are to any of this. And, you know, we aren't managing ecosystems, we're managing people, right? And we've kind of highlighted that, I think, today a bit more. And I think that's where I start to realize that we're using ecological data, We're using social data, we're using governance data, we're using physical information, and we're putting it all together in ways that we can show how healthy the ecosystem is, but how we define how healthy the ecosystem is really depends on people's perspectives. And it's really, you really have to take into account what the benefits are people are getting from the ocean and how they value those benefits to decide sort of where you want to go next with your management. And I think as much as, you know, we think of it as a science and we're measuring ecosystem indicators and we're looking at variables, in the end, what we're really trying to do is influence social dimensions and social dynamics. And I think the Ocean Health Index does a good job of not only incorporating that type of data into the calculations, but also interpreting that data in ways that resonate with people and that can then impact the social dimensions of things. So I think my transition with the Ocean Health Index has been that when we're talking about ecosystems, we aren't just talking about the species that are in the ecosystem. We're talking about humans as like a fundamental part of that in every dimension as we think about ocean health.
Great, thanks. Emily, your thoughts?
I would totally echo that because I also am coming at this from a science background, and I used to think that like environmental scientists will save the world. Like, this is why I'm doing this. But now I kind of think like behavioral scientists will save the world. and so much so that I'm starting to read more about that. And so OHI, like Courtney said, I think really gives folks the tools to figure out what dials to tweak on behavior and communicating with people and make sure they receive the right message. I was also a little bit, you know, I had come into this thinking like data have to be perfect and you have to have the data really strongly support a particular trends assessment or something in order to get people to believe you or in order to publish. And the OHI, like, you guys are so creative about how you use the data. I'm inspired by that. And it's not meant as a backwards insult or anything. You really, the synthesis and the creativity in data analysis to pull the most you can out of every data set and find value in every data set is something that I learned from you guys. And I think, I hope I carry that forward in my work. But we really should be trying to squeeze every piece of value out of data. And just because it has some, you know, weaknesses, it doesn't mean it's useless and we'll never reach an assessment endpoint if we let perfect be the enemy of the good. So I think that's another lesson learned for me.
That's great, thanks. Eric, anything else to add?
Yeah, I will say this two pieces that have been profound for me and I carry with me. One is just the inherent trade-offs in all decision makings and how the Ocean Health Index just helps you quantify those things. And sometimes we know these things anecdotally, but once you start like pitting things against each other and really get people to make those difficult decisions. And I think that's something that's been profound about me is sometimes there isn't always a win-win situation, right? Sometimes you do have to make difficult decisions, and those are values-based decisions, right? It's like what Courtney was saying is we're not managing ecosystems, we're managing people. And to what Emily was saying about, the behavioral, one thing that was profound about me is when I reflect on kind of the places where I felt we were most successful is there was always one or two amazing champions there, just, you know, that knew how to navigate those systems, that knew how to navigate this, make the change happen, right? They knew what levers to push and pull. And that's something I keep thinking about any kind of change management processes. You need to figure out who are those champions that know how to navigate those systems and know how to, you know, facts alone, the data and the science alone is not enough, right? And we're seeing that, you know, this administration showed us that the facts alone don't matter, right? It's you need influence. And for me, that was something that was really profound that the Ocean Health Index taught me was, you know, how do you couple the science with the influence and the policies, and all of that equals change.
Great. That's really helpful and interesting to hear these perspectives. So I want to turn to the idea of partnerships. We've talked a lot about that as kind of foundational to how the index works, and in every place we go and everything we've done, it's been a partnership between science and either organizations or agencies that help think about implementing the index. And so Emily, you've been part of a government agency or affiliated, and Eric, you were part of Conservation International. Can you each kind of reflect on what is unique about the partnerships that you were involved with in the OHI, and how those partnerships played a role in kind of how you approached working on the Ocean Health Index? Maybe Emily first.
Sure. So the partnership that I was involved in with OHI was a regional ocean partnership, which is a group of federal agencies, state agencies, and tribes and other stakeholders that come together and think about ocean planning, coordinate on how to use data, where to get the best data, among other things. And so it was really interesting to observe individual agencies' reactions and participation in OHI as driven by politics. And this gets a little bit to what Eric was talking about with national level politics, but it is, I've been involved with this group now through several administrations, and it's really striking how much of a difference it makes when you can, as an agency staff member, openly talk about climate change and not be afraid that something's going to happen to you. Or you can openly talk about, different potentially controversial topics. So there's this really important, as it goes to the relationship building, there's this really important nexus where you have a supportive federal administration, and you also have all the states being supportive that we were never actually able to achieve when we were working on OHI. It was either the federal administration is supportive, but there's one state that has a Republican governor that you can't even talk about ocean health. Or vice versa, the states are all now into it, but the federal agencies just, they have to stay away from it or they'll get themselves into trouble. And so it's again about sort of the relationship building and the partnership building that shocked me. But I think that was, I felt bad that I had to keep bringing that to the table when we discussed progress on the OHI project, because I'm like, well, so-and-so dropped out because it's a political thing or something. I'm sure that existed elsewhere, but I felt that was particularly influential in our case study.
Great. And Eric, any thoughts?
Yeah, I will share that I remember when Julie and I first started envisioning what those assessments would look like, we were the process is just as important as the assessments, and the more I worked in OHI, the more I realized that completing assessments was nice to have, but not always necessary to make changes, and I'll share a few examples on those. There were places in which we were able to put in place meaningful policies to change ocean and coastal management without completing assessments, but using the OHI as a framework to have conversations in places like Indonesia and South Korea, Mexico, Colombia, Samoa. We were able to put in place either policies or governance structures by simply getting people to talk about ocean management more holistically, right? It's integrated, it's not siloed. We were able to put in place capacity development, right, around ocean and coastal management, not just at a scientific high level, but what does that mean in practice at smaller geographies, right? In smaller parts of your countries where there might be less scientific know-how or management know-how. To put in place better data collections, right? Sometimes just even telling people, if you want to do this kind of assessment, you need this type of data, you don't have it. And you just get people to go, oh, okay, we need to fund data, right? And put in our budgets. And that takes time, right? But getting people to think about those things, right? And there's a lag behind all of these things. Participatory decision-making, just getting players around the table. Sometimes it's just government bureaucrats sitting in their office making decisions. And I remember one time we did a workshop in the British Virgin Islands, and just a group of fishermen showed up, right? And I was like, that was awesome. Like, just, and they showed up in their rags, you know, they're just very informal. And they're like, no, that policy would have this consequence. No, we can't do this in this area. We can do this in that area, or talking about the temporal elements of their fisheries, setting vision common targets, you know, setting those benchmarks was awesome. Like, and we didn't get to do assessments in all of these places, but there's benchmarks that those countries are working towards. The other thing was these partnerships that the Ocean Health Index created across multiple boundaries, right? And, you know, the NCEAS led an amazing project in the Baltic Sea that brought together six different countries, right, to provide a common language and a common platform to talk about these issues and collective management. In Latin America, we worked with the Permanent Commission of the Pacific Southeast that brings together Panama, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, and Chile. And then we added Mexico, and we ended up having this shared learning exchanges about what works, what doesn't work, what are you doing over there that's working for you, what's not working, and just getting these kind of communities of practice, sharing kind of knowledge and what works. We did the same thing in Asia with the partnerships for environmental management of the seas of East Asia with Korea and Indonesia and Malaysia and Thailand. And we did a OHI pilot in Kenya and Tanzania, bringing these two countries together, or with the Pacific Regional Environmental Program with Fiji and Samoa and New Caledonia. So the Ocean Health Index really provided this common framework to get these countries to say, you know, well, you know, the whatever you do in your country is affecting me. And so we need to be in tandem and get on the same page. And we can't have very separate goals about our fisheries, because if you overfish over there, well, those fisheries migrate and affect me as well. And so it was fantastic to see how it provided this mechanism to get countries to collaborate and work together and set common visions and common targets and talk about collaborations on both the science and the management, the policy and the governance.
Thanks, Eric. I want to remind folks who are listening in, if you have questions for the panelists, please go ahead and put them in the chat. I can see them there, and I'll pose them on your behalf to the panelists. So please feel free to do that. So as I mentioned at the beginning, next year will be our 10th year of doing global assessments, which is quite a milestone and pretty exciting, but it hopefully isn't the last year. We have another 10 years and beyond after that. I'm curious, Courtney in particular, but others, if you have thoughts on this, like what would you like to see accomplished through the Ocean Health Index partnership in the coming 10 years? Is there some aspiration or hope that you have for it?
You know, when I think about this, there isn't like a big, huge, like new accomplishment that I want the Ocean Health Index to make. Like, I don't think there's a huge scientific breakthrough that we need to make. But what I hope is there is more of this coalition building that Eric's been talking about. And there's more kind of community self-organizing around the world around the Ocean Health Index. Communities who are doing an Ocean Health Index, helping each other to not only get the science right, but get this partnership building right, and sort of share the knowledge that they've gained through doing their own process, and just kind of allowing for the Ocean Health Index to make it to more places and in those places move through time. So not be a one-time thing that people spend years creating an Ocean Health Index for their ocean in their backyard, and then that's it. Like I want the Ocean Health Index to be able to be something that tracks change through time in all of these places, and where there's support for yearly assessments in these places, so that people can see how Ocean Health Index is changing through time and really be able to monitor things more closely and understand how dynamics change and what that means for the ocean health. So it's more of, you know, incremental changes for me than it is a huge change, because I think we're on track. It's just a matter of, you know, keeping on and getting the word out and having kind of more people involved in doing this on the ground.
Thanks. Emily or Eric, do you have any additional thoughts on that?
Yeah, I'm glad Courtney touched on some of these things. And I think while I was still at Conservation International, we might have talked about this, but it's we had talked about maybe the idea of having regional OHI hubs around the world of a community of practice, right? If we have a country that's already done it successfully, how can they help other countries do it? And really think about a global ocean health coalition, right? How do we bring more players to the game, right? Not just NCEAS and nonprofits, but, you know, what would it look like to have foundations and private sector and national and regional governments and really think about, you know, what would it mean to move the needle on the ocean globally, right? And what players can commit to kind of having like a Paris Agreement for the oceans, right? And I think the Ocean Health Index really provides the platform to doing those kinds of things. You know, we saw with the UN Sustainable Goals, you know, that was, we were excited to do that. And it just, again, became another kind of scientific wonky thing. We're going to put people here, oceans over here. And, you know, I just don't think that's the right approach, right? If you don't center people and they don't see themselves in as being a key element of the ocean, it's going to be hard to convince folks to do the right thing.
Great, thanks. I want to shift gears, kind of more general, like still from the perspective of what you've experienced and learned and done with Ocean Health Index, but just kind of how it shapes your thinking about oceans and ocean health and how we assess that. So two questions related to that. One of them, for any or all of you, if you have thoughts on this, like what is the kind of information or tools that you think people in the general public need to be better stewards of marine environments in their own backyards? And, you know, how has the Ocean Health Index informed or supported kind of your thinking around that? Maybe Emily, if you want to take a first stab at that.
Sure. Yeah. I had some recent experiences about this that helped me think about my answer for this question, actually. I think that we underestimate the tools, or maybe we overestimate the tools that people need. I've got to think through my wording on this. The general public is like really eager and able to do systems level thinking. It has surprised me in my work. We often as scientists assume we have to explain every connection in an ecosystem or connections to human well-being. People get it innately. So I think we just need to show them the data, show them the information and give them access to it. And people are able to make these linkages. They're able to interpret and do all of that on their own with very little guidance. I think we as scientists sometimes assume that so much text and narrative is going to need to go along with these figures to be able to make them, you know, intuitive to people or to explain them, or we're going to have to lay out every element of the ecosystem and draw a complex systems diagram to make it clear to people that everything's connected. And if we, you know, change water quality, it's going to have all of these flow down effects, cascading effects. People get that. I mean, I think we just need to keep giving them access to information, and OHI does that very well.
That's great. Courtney, you have any thoughts?
Yeah, I would just add like sort of one fundamental thing for me in terms of just getting people to appreciate ocean in their backyard and become better stewards is like getting out there and observing it themselves. So, you know, just getting out there more often, seeing how their environment is changing, maybe why it's changing, and just sort of becoming better, all of us becoming better observers of our environment. And I do think, you know, I think COVID has made us kind of more place-based people, place-based species in our system. And I think people are observing more kind of what happens in their own backyard, literally, because they're there more often these days. But I think the same could go for the ocean, you know, just the more you observe it, the more you see kind of how you fit into it, how things change, what's driving those changes. And then I think you can kind of feel like you're a part of it and become a better steward of that place that you care about.
Great. Erich, do you have any thoughts on that?
You know, I think there's two things. One is, how do we talk about tipping points in more plain language? I think, you know, if it comes to climate or oceans, I don't think people grasp how close we are getting to some of these tipping points, right? People are like, oh, it's getting worse, whatever. And we need more kind of average folks to be able to grasp how, in more common terms, how close we are to getting some of this, you know, positive feedback loops in really bad ways. The other thing is, and I agree with Emily, is, you know, given the right set of choices, people will choose to make the right choice, right? And so people vote with their wallets every day, with the things that they purchase, with the activities that they buy, the places they decide to stay in. And so, you know, I can't remember, but it might have been somebody at WWF many years ago. He said, we can't always let it to the consumers to make these choices. We need to make it so all the choices that consumers can make are good choices. And how do we use our collective purchasing power as consumers to push upwards into the markets and demand and request? And I don't think as consumers, we always have that information. And I always try to make the best kind of most environmental, but I don't always have that information, right? And so can I have a little bit more transparency and demand that transparency from various producers, from our seafood to our tourism or whatever it might be, right?
Great. All right, one other question on kind of the general sense of, that's a nice place to begin to wrap up our conversation. Again, folks, if you want to ask the panel any questions, please add your questions to the chat window. You've spent a lot of time now thinking about the health of the ocean through the initiative, the Ocean Health Index, but also your other work. And I'm curious what you think about the future of the ocean, especially in your backyard. Are you optimistic? Are you hopeful? What's your sense of where things are headed? And maybe we'll start with Emily.
I am optimistic. I feel like I always am about environmental issues, and maybe that's a weakness, but I'm optimistic. We have some big changes coming in our region with the development of offshore wind at really broad scales. That was something that we talked about at the very beginning of our OHI project, that we would have loved to be able to fold into the OHI up here in the Northeast, but things were just beginning and just getting off the ground that we weren't able to. And that's something that I see as a huge opportunity in the future, is understanding these changes. We're, you know, trying to balance clean energy, future, and sustainability, but also the sustainability of our marine ecosystems, our ocean ecosystems. And so I'm optimistic that we'll be able to figure it out. But it's a huge challenge. And like Eric said, sometimes the general public can not get a full grasp on the scale of some of these issues or particular tipping points. And the scale of changes in the ecosystem in the Northern Atlantic and in the Mid-Atlantic is about to be really big. And so I'm cautiously optimistic that we will be able to monitor and intervene if we need to, or figure out, you know, creative solutions to address any issues that come up. But that's what I'll be thinking about probably for the next 20 or more years.
Yeah. What about you, Eric?
You know, as a fairly recent transplant to Oregon, I will say, you know, I'm also optimistic. I mean, I'm seeing, you know, we in the last few years have added a couple of new marine reserves here. And you know, when I look at what the state is doing and within the 3 nautical miles that they control, I see a lot of reasons to be optimistic on just how the fisheries are being managed and the stewardship that I also see from coastal communities and just the general population being more environmentally aware. I mean, obviously it is Oregon. I think there is a little bit more of people live here because they love nature and their environment, and there's that really a sense, a strong sense of place here, I would say. And, you know, but that gives me reason to be optimist, is that the attitudes of people and how they interact with their environment are changing, and I see people making more responsible choices.
Great, thanks. And Courtney, I'm going to give you the last word, and then we'll turn it over to the organizers to wrap things up.
Yeah, you know, I'm optimistic too. I think especially getting out there with the Ocean Health Index and talking to people across, you know, the country, across the world who are, you know, involved in the ocean, whether it's, somebody who's a fisherman or somebody who is a tourist or somebody who does marine science. Like, the more you talk to people, the more you realize that, like Emily said, people really do think system-wide. People aren't just thinking about the one thing that they care about and that's it. I think we often kind of assume people are only acting in their own self-interest, but I think the more you talk to people about the ocean, the more you realize that they really do have a more holistic perspective on it, and that they are seeing changes and that they do really care about what's happening. And I think just that sort of sentiment makes me optimistic that people really care about the ocean and they want to see good things happen. And if we have that as a kind of a foundation for everything else, I think we're in better shape than we might expect.
Great, and we actually have a question from the chat, so I don't want to let that drop before we wrap things up. It's actually someone calling in from the Czech Republic, which is very exciting, who's asking about, like, how do we engage new opportunities in new countries or new places in terms of the communication? Do people reach out to us? Do we reach out to them? Is it governments? Is it universities? Is it NGOs? Does it differ from each case to case? I think there's an interest in understanding, how does a new Ocean Health Index initiative start? And if one or more of you want to just give a quick short answer to your perspective on that, that would be great.
I would start by saying yes, all of those things have probably happened in the past. Sometimes it's a place that really, you know, hears about the Ocean Health Index, really gets motivated and wants to do one for the region. And in that case, they'll reach out to us, and we have a lot of tools and resources that we can kind of help people start that process. Sometimes it is an agency or even, a funding group that really wants to learn more about the place that they care about. And in that case, they'll come to us and we'll start to build partnerships to make sure that we get it right, get the science right, get the partnerships right in that place. And sometimes it is somebody working on a PhD program. Sometimes it's a scientist who's running it. Sometimes it's not a scientist at all, somebody who just really cares about the ocean. So there's a lot of different ways that the Ocean Health Index has come about in different places. I think it just takes, you know, a champion to want to make it happen. And then we can kind of build that coalition to make it happen.
Great. Thanks, Courtney. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Sarah to wrap it up, but just thank you to Eric, Emily, and Courtney. It's been fun to see you guys and connect on this and hear your perspectives on your experiences with Ocean Health Index. So thank you for that. Sarah.
Yes, thank you, Eric, Emily, Ben, and Courtney for the really insightful comments and wonderful discussion. I'm so appreciative for all you do to help protect and keep our oceans healthy. As a native Minnesotan, I will share Emily's cautious optimism. I've been in California for 20 plus years now, but I feel like my conversations with my Minnesota family continue to get more deep on ocean health. So it's not just sense of place in your backyard, but I think globally we're seeing some really nice improvements, at least in terms of awareness and people wanting to help be part of the solutions. Thank you, audience, for taking the time to be with us today. If you have any follow-up questions, feel free. You can find Ben, Courtney's, or my contact information on the NCEAS website, so feel free to reach out to us and we'd be happy to chat with you further. I know the Zoom world is busy these days with lots of online events, so we really appreciate you taking the time to choose this event and join us today. And if you want to watch it again or share it with your friends, it'll be on the NCEAS YouTube website. And if you'd like to join us for more conversations, our last seminar will be next Thursday, December 10th at noon Pacific Standard Time, where Caitlin Gaynor, who's a postdoctoral researcher with NCEAS, will be discussing the impacts of COVID-19 on wildlife. So we hope you can join us for that and have a wonderful afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye, all. Thanks for having me.